I pray tonight that we would immerse ourselves in the reckless love of God. Amen. That we would encounter Him in such a way that it would literally break chains and remove whatever is hindering us from encountering Him in a transformational way from the inside out. Amen?
Amen.
I have a passage of scripture that just blows my mind. And it's probably been one of my favorites since early on. And you're going to see that it's written on the wall out there if you haven't noticed already. And weren't those things nice out there? You noticed it?
Yeah.
Oh, three of you. Okay, well, that's all right. Isaiah 61. It says, "The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is upon me because the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty and freedom to the captives, and the opening of the prisons to those who are bound, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to grant to those who mourn in Zion to give them a beautiful headdress instead of ash, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the garment of praise instead of a faint spirit, that they may be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that He may be glorified." Jesus quoted this scripture when He came out of the desert after 40 days. And He went to the synagogue and He had told them this passage of scripture was fulfilled in their hearing. That the Anointed One had come. And then we know that He says that as the Father has sent me, I am now sending you to bind up the brokenhearted. Because the Spirit of God is on you. Amen?
Amen.
Well, listen to what I want you to do. I want you to turn around and say, "The Spirit of the living God is on you." All right? Make a friend. Say hello to somebody you might not have met before. Awesome. Awesome, awesome.
You guys are great.
Oh, so good to see you.
Great job, guys. Well, it works. What do you mean?
Ha ha. All right. Woo-hoo. What an awesome, friendly group of people. Feel free to grab your seats. My name's Eddie. I'm one of the pastors here at New Hope. And I want to welcome all our first-time guests and returning guests that are here with us today. And I want our first-time guests to know how New Hope is a place for imperfect people to belong, to grow, to serve, and to find healing and hope. And we endeavor to do that by loving Jesus, loving people, and serving our city and the world. And I can't thank you guys enough because you guys make it look so easy. Yeah. Did anybody get a weekend program? If you didn't get one, raise your hand. Listen, there is so much stuff going on. And I'm not going to mention all. I'm just going to mention really one thing in the program. A couple of years ago, we realized that because of the neighborhood that we're living in, this section of Northport is the oldest section of Northport. And a lot of the homes were built in the 50s and 60s and 70s. And It's pretty much all well developed. All the houses are kind of stacked together, and they're kind of smaller homes. And this particular area has high poverty rate, high crime rate. And there's a small little park. It's called Kirk Park. How many people have gone to Kirk Park? Okay. Yeah, about 8, 9 of you guys. All right, great. Well, anyway, so that park has had a history of drugs and some other things. And so a few years back, we adopted it. We went to the city commission. We said that we're going to believe God to redeem that and see that park used for the glory of God, for the community, not for us. And so we meet there every month as a staff, and we have prayer time, and we clean up whatever's there. And so we like doing events. We had done an event there probably a little bit over a year ago, and the neighborhood came out in an unbelievable way. They said, I've lived in this house right across the street from the park for 17 years. This is the only time there's ever been an event in this park. And that is not acceptable. And so on Labor Day, I know that's a Labor Day, is a holiday, and we're going to have a worship at the park. And festival, it's going to be a fabulous thing. There's going to be stuff for kids, there's going to be prizes, all kinds of stuff. I can't encourage you enough. I just want that whole park so full of people for Jesus. And to let our community know that we haven't forgotten them, that God loves them, and because God loves them, God has put in our heart to come here in a practical way and show you God's love. Amen? So anyway, there's just pray. If you're not able to make it, I get that, because you have family and your own barbecues that you're going to. It's going to be in English and Spanish. We're going to have our Spanish praise. We're going to have a Spanish praise team, an English praise team. I think Celebrate Recovery might have a team there as well. It's going to be awesome. And it's just going to be a great, great time. And we're just going to love people for Jesus. Amen? All right, where are my kids? Come on up, guys. All right. Woo-hoo. There you go. Good job. Hey, buddy. Good job. Well, listen, we love children here at New Hope, and I want to just thank all the parents for graciously bringing them and just an opportunity for us to be able to have this small time and really kind of come alongside what you guys are doing at home and helping them know a lot about the gospel and those types of truths. And so, hey, you're okay? Good job, good job. All right. That's what's going to get you hurt. So, but anyway, I want to say thank you, because your generosity allows us to have these wonderful environments for our children, for our middle and high schoolers and the modulars. And there's constantly always they're redesigning and repainting and putting up these beautiful biblical mosaics for the children to kind of see also in artwork. The stories of the Bible. It's just a great, great, great opportunity. And so if you wouldn't mind, we'd just like to bless them as they go off to their classes. And so, Father, we thank you, Lord, for these children. We thank you, Lord, for our middle and high schools. We pray your blessing over their lives. We thank you, Father, for all our gospel-transformed servant leaders that worked on teaching the scriptures of God, Father, to all your people. So, Father, thank you, Lord, for all that you do. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. All right. Woohoo.
To a wave of cheers, Pastor Rick Warren, in his trademark black t-shirt, walked onto the stage with his wife Kay for the first time in 4 months to deliver his weekly sermon.
Love you too.
It was back in April when the Warrens' 27-year-old son Matthew, beset by unrelieved depression, shot himself to death. The pastor spoke about the tragedy.
And we went over to his house, and we couldn't get in, and we're thinking, that which I feared most has happened.
Andy talked about how Matthew's older siblings had tried to help him through his illness.
Amy and Josh talked him off the ledge time after time. And they are really my heroes.
But Rick Warren's status in many eyes as his generation's Billy Graham was built on his reputation as a teacher who made Christianity's lessons accessible, a bestseller that sold millions, a figure at the side of presidents, would-be presidents, and world leaders. And when his son died, other religious leaders predicted Warren would eventually extract the lessons in his family's personal tragedy.
Using this opportunity to recognize, hey, we can do the best we can do and still fail.
And that's what Warren set out to do.
I was kind of grieving, but I was also watching my own grief. And as a teacher, I was saying, what am I experiencing? And how can I share that with others?
One lesson, that the tragedy of Matthew's suicide doesn't require someone to blame, as Kay Warren explained.
My love was simply not enough to overcome the brick wall of mental illness.
The pastor went further.
All of Matthew's life, because of his mental illness, he struggled with questions. But I want to tell you this. He wasn't in heaven one second, and all of his questions were answered.
A pastor whose teachings reach millions, back at work. For today, Mike Taibbi, NBC News, Los Angeles.
Woo! All right. Yeah, it's quiet in here. Before we go any further, let's take a moment and pause and just invite the Holy Spirit to come, to just open the Word of God to us and begin to really bring healing and hope, as well as to begin to wrestle with some of the huge, huge issues in our generation, and I'm going to say our city. Northport has probably one of the highest suicide rates in the region. And I'm their department, the Northport Department Police Chaplains. I get called out so many times. I mean, it's, there are times I just can't wrap my mind around it. But we're going to allow God to speak, and he's going to have his way. Amen? Let's bow our heads and pray. Father, as we gather here, before your throne of grace, I pray, Father, first and foremost, Lord, we would just immerse ourselves in your reckless love, Lord. Father, that we would stop trying to hear all the other voices and quiet our soul before you to hear your voice. Father, I confess, Lord, that, Lord, the weight of depression, Father, Lord, for many of us, Lord, is just so heavy, Lord, that at times, Lord, I even guard myself, Lord, from those who are going through it, Lord, because it's just like a, Father, a weight has just fell on your chest. And so, Lord, we come, Lord, and we ask, Lord, that you would just, Father, wreck our hearts over the things that wreck your heart. Lord, give us your eyes to see and your ears to hear today, we ask. In your Son's precious name, amen. Moses, Elijah, Jonah, all felt so bad, the scripture teaches us, that they wanted to end their lives. Research and all the studies are showing us that almost everybody has felt suicidal at some low point in their life, even God's people. And so I want to say today is, if there is anyone in this room that might even feel that way, first I want to say to you that I want to encourage you and thank you that you're here, because I believe that is a great step to moving into healing and hope. Because you're in a safe place. You're in a room, and even though I know for many you're just seeing the back of people's heads, but you're in a safe place full of people who are struggling and working out this life just like you are. And now I believe that it is our heart and our goal that we would encounter him together and walk that out. And second, I want to not only encourage those who might be feeling that way, but also those who might know a family member or a friend or a neighbor or a coworker. And I'm gonna specifically ask you, don't wait. I want you to call this number. It's 1-800-273-TALK. That's the National Suicide Prevention Lifeline. And for those who have maybe a family member, a friend, there's where you're going to find the resources and the availability of support groups. If you look in your weekend program, there on the back of the sermon notes, I've given you all the lists of stuff that I could find. And I'm sure there's many more. But it's just a resource for you. And there are many organizations and many places that print this small. So bring out I try to squeeze it all in one sheet. See, this is what I want you to know, that it's not sin to feel bad or to be sick. And an illness does not determine your identity or my identity in Christ. And for this reason is why we are continuing our study called The Elephant in the Room, to expose and to offer biblical answers to some of life's most troublesome issues as we look to Jesus to handle some of these huge problems in our lives with humility and grace and truth, so that revival and healing may have come in your life and in my life and in those that we love. So today, let's expose the elephant in the closet who's hiding and is causing this epidemic called suicide in our generation, in our community, and specifically in our cities. And what I think it's so important that we expose it, is because we want to begin to destroy the appeal of suicide. Think about that for a second. We've glamorized it so much. You know what the studies say? It's that it is the second most killer from the age of 15 to 24 in that generation. I can't even imagine that. And my heart just breaks, totally breaks, over the reality of that particular truth. Because this is why we have to destroy the appeal of suicide. Because the Bible clearly teaches, okay, don't believe me because I say so, read it in the book for yourself. Suicide is a sin. Because it is self-murder. And only God has the right to determine a person's death. But here's the good news. The gospel, and of what Jesus has done, that it is not the unpardonable sin. Blasphemy of the Holy Spirit is the only one that Scripture talks about. That's a whole new teaching. Consider this also, which I think is so important, that the enemy of your soul and my soul, the Bible calls him the devil, Satan, Lucifer, he has many names in the Scripture, is not terrified by your past or my past. The enemy of our soul is terrified about your future and my future in Christ. And he's going to do everything possible to cut that life short, to cut that destiny short. That is what terrifies him. And we got to be out there proclaiming the good news of Jesus and the reckless love of God to destroy this appeal that is just prevalent from Hollywood to everything you look at, that the best way to handle pain or problems in your life is to check out. I am convinced that this is the reason why every day you and I have to enter into the battle for hope. It's not a one-time battle. Every single day, you and I need a battle for hope, because the amount of pressure that is hitting every single one of us, that is the only way that's going to be able to destroy this appeal of suicide and the depression that is so rampant in our culture and in our society. And it's on many levels. And it tries to lead you and me to just give up and quit. And it starts out in small little places until eventually we just say, I just might as well just check out altogether. In today's scripture passage that we're going to look at today, we're going to unpack three, or I'm going to call three things that God does to empower you and me to victory, to this battle for hope, so that we'd be able to then destroy the appeal of suicide. So, the first thing that God does is that God sends, okay? We're going to unpack that a little bit. God sends. Second thing that God does is that God listens. And the third thing is that God gives, okay? God, by the grace of God, He sends, He listens, and He gives. And we're going to see that in the life of Elijah. So if you don't mind opening up your Bibles or taking out your cell phones and tablets, wherever you have them, we're going to look at 1 Kings chapter 19. Now Ahab told Jezebel everything Elijah had done and how he had killed all the prophets with the sword. So Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah to say, May the gods deal with me, be it ever so severely, if by this time tomorrow I do not make your life like one of them. Elijah was afraid and ran for his life. When he came to Beersheba in Judah, he left his servant there, while he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness. He came to a broom brush, sat down under it, and prayed that he might die. He wanted to check out. I've had enough. Lord, he said, take my life. I'm no better than my ancestors. Then he lay down under the bush and fell asleep. All at once, an angel touched him and said, get up and eat. He looked around, and there by his head was some bread baked over hot coals, a jar of water. He ate and drank, and then he lay down again. The angel of the Lord came back a second time and touched him and said, get up and eat, for the journey is too much for you. So he got up and ate and drank, strengthened by that food. He traveled 40 days and 40 nights until he reached Horeb, the mountain of God. There he went into a cave and spent the night. And the word of the Lord came to him. What are you doing here, Elijah? He replied, I have been very zealous for the Lord your God. Almighty, the Israelites have rejected your covenants, torn down your altars, and put your prophets to death with the sword. I am the only one left. And now they are trying to kill me too. The Lord said, go out and stand on the mountain in the presence of the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by. Then a great and powerful wind tore the mountain apart and shattered the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind, there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake came a fire, and the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire came a gentle whisper. When Elijah heard it, he pulled his cloak over his face and went out and stood at the mouth of the cave. Then a voice said to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He replied, "I have been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected," he's repeating himself, "rejected your covenant, torn down your altars, put your prophets to death. I am the only one left, and now they are trying to kill me too." And then the Lord said to him, "Go back the way you came and go to the desert of Damascus. There you get, when you get there, anoint Hazael, king of Aram. Also anoint Jehu, son of Nimash, king over Israel, and anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat, from Abel Mehlath, to succeed you as prophet. Jehu will put to death any who escape the sword of Hazael, and Elijah will put to death any who escape the sword of Jehu. Yet I reserve 7,000 in Israel, all whom knees have not bowed down to Baal and whose mouth have not kissed him." All right, let's pause right there. Let me give you a little backdrop here before we kind of... Chapter 18, here's Elijah. God speaks to him for 3 years. He's out in the desert. He's, you know, ravens are taking care of him. God's doing just some miraculous things. God calls him now to confront Ahab. He brings all the prophets of Baal and over to this one location. All Israel comes to look. And then he challenges them. If your God is God, then let him call fire down on this altar, and that'll prove to everyone here that he's God. And so they went, and like 800 of them, they went, they cut themselves, and they're jumping up and down. They're doing all their wigamaboo and whatever, and nothing. Till they're near exhaustion. Elijah sets up an altar, and he says, "Listen, you know what? Bring buckets of water. All right? They throw tons of water, so much water, the rivers are flowing out of the altar, there's so much water." And then he calls on the God, and the fire of God comes, and it burns the altar and the offering and all the water that was there. An unbelievable, miraculous move of God. They slaughter the prophets of Baal, it's a great victory. No sooner than that victory, and there's some other miracles that he'd done along the way, it's a great chapter. Chapter 18, 19, just spend the rest of the week. You'll get some great nuggets out of that. Then he comes to 19, and Jezebel threatens him, and he falls apart. And now he wants to die. I would probably say that Elijah is no different than you or me. We are all flawed, unqualified, and broken. Most important, I don't want us to focus on Elijah and his brokenness, because you and I, we already know that. We already know how broken we are. And if you're not, then we'll come up in the altar. We're going to pray for denial. Remove that. But I want you to see how God addresses broken, hurting people. There is so much lies out in the world and in the culture. We'd run to 15 other things except running to God. And here, I think, is probably one of the best passage scriptures to see how God responds. Look at... verse 3. Elijah was afraid. Elijah was afraid, and then God sends an angel. Okay? In other words, God knew the condition, because it says all at once. Don't ever believe that God, who is recklessly in love with you, is not paying attention to you in your circumstances. God sends. And I want you to get the understanding is here. If here's Elijah, a powerful prophet of God. He knows the word. He probably knows it better than you and me. He can quote it. I mean, he gets revelation. The guy has done signs and miracles. I mean, a powerful prophet. And he's not immune to depression. We got to start breaking the stigmatism of this thing and realize that none of us in this room is immune to depression. Elijah's, you look at Elijah's depression, I think there was a few things that we need to see. One was, there was fear. All of us at some point get afraid about one thing or another. He was afraid about Jezebel's threat. And I want you to kind of, was it that the threat represents a whole bunch of things, okay? Elijah had this massive, massive miracle of God, power of God, this, that, and the other thing. His entire life has been spent that Israel would be restored, that there would be revival, that there would be a removal of the wicked leadership in the country, and all of a sudden, every hope and every dream that he had. And now the miracle's there. He was out in the desert. It comes to him and God uses him. 800 of all the prophets of Baal are gone. He runs after Ahab. I mean, he's running after us, but it's a miracle because he's catching up to a horse. And then I can only put myself in his mind. When you think that all of a sudden I'm going to now see the people going to rise. Okay, everybody's going to start praising God. They're going to start tearing down all the worship things, all the different altars and demonic things that are all over. And Jezebel is still in power. Ahab has not repented. The people are not turning back to God. They're still supporting her. He is crushed. All his hopes, all his dreams. Everything that you and I would have ever dreamed in our entire life. And now, there's no revival, there's no revolution. I mean, I don't even get a plaque. Where's my plaque? I just killed 800 prophets of Baal. The fire of God came down. Nothing. And he's afraid. And just imagine, put yourself in his shoes. I mean, what would he be experiencing? What is he afraid of? Afraid of failure, maybe? A life of loneliness? I'm the only one left. I mean, think, who's going to hire a broken-down prophet that can't get anything done? I don't know. Everything is falling apart. His depression is full of fear, it's full of, I believe, failure. I mean, Elijah has a negative opinion about himself. He says, I am no better than my ancestors. Okay, now you gotta understand, okay? His ancestors, okay, were the ones who are murdering the prophets, okay? You know, the ones who are rejecting God, the ones who are following after all the pleasures of Egypt and disregarding the law and all the prophets and he has a negative view of himself. I'm no good. I'm incompetent. God must have made a mistake picking me as a prophet. He's exhausted, fatigued, emotionally, mentally drained. Some of us can kind of relate. I want to tell you that depression always is related to you and me physically. When we are physically exhausted, physically drained, the reason why God commands, not suggested, that you and I would rest and Sabbath. Because it's just a matter of time before you and I crash. Crash will always lead you and me to a wrong opinion of ourselves, that God somehow got it wrong. Depression is always knocking on my door. jump down, verse, end of verse 9. It says, and the word of the Lord came to him, what are you doing here, Elijah? I want you to get this kind of picture. God asks a question, okay? And sometimes we think, well, you know, like, God is just going to just so angry, he's going to squash us with this question. He just asks a question. And then, and then Elijah goes on this rantage, right? Oh, you know, he replied, I have been zealous for you. I mean, don't you see what I'm doing? Can't you see all the work, all the hard stuff I've done? I got no plaque. There's no revival. I mean, there's no statue for me. What's going on here? I've been living out in the cave by myself for years. No friends, no family. I can't go out. No barbecues. I'm zealous for you, God. It's not working out. You're laughing because it relates. I get it. See, God gives him a word. God goes and he says, listen, what are you doing? And then he allows him to rant and rave, and God listens to him. You know, some of you, I think, don't rant and rave enough to God. I yell at him. I get angry. If I do that to Norma, she hits me. Just a joke. Just a joke. Three ways. I want you to see three things here, which I think are so powerful. When here's what God does when he's listening, okay? He wants you to know that God, our God, is so crazy about you that he's concerned about every area of life, every aspect. Did you notice that when he runs off and he just feels like a failure, he's full of fear, he's just exhausted, you know, feels his life is just totally futile, haven't accomplished anything, and he's exhausted. And then God sends an angel and touches him. Did you see the tenderness of that? The Bible says that we have to entertain strangers because we don't really know if they're a stranger or an angel. Well, God has sent you, a body of believers here, to be God's hands and feet, to bring comfort in the times of your sorrow and your grief. And many times we push them away. Like Elijah, did you also realize that when Elijah was running away, his only friend that he had, what did he do? Isn't that what we immediately isolate ourselves? We push ourselves around from people who can help us, and then we go sulk. God sent an angel. And then that angel touched him, cooked him a dinner, and then told him to go take a nap. In other words, that when you, here's God and he's dealing with his depression, his suicidal tendencies, and he takes care of him physically. That's very, very important. You know, I think sometimes when we're so broken and we feel like a failure, we feel like Elijah, we just need to take a nap. Take a nap. It's not going to kill you taking a nap. And it could probably give you, in other words, he's saying, rest. God's in control. God has a plan. I'm going to make it work. You don't make it work. Our Heavenly Father makes it work. You know, and the struggle is that, you know, sometimes God reaches in physically, but it's not exclusively physically. He didn't say, well, the cure for depression or suicidal tendencies is just to be taken care of physically. It's a piece, but it's not totally the whole piece. Because if we did, then they would just be, hey, all I need to do is just take a nap. Anytime I feel bad, I feel better when I wake up, right? I just got to just reduce my stress level or take a pill. Give me another pill. It'll be over with. Take care. I'm done. It's a peace. But he takes care of us physically. Did you see that he also dealt with him spiritually? He addresses, he sends an angel. Not only that it touches him, but he deals with the wrong view that he has of God. Here's God listening to him, and he's got this whole going, oh, you know what I mean? I've been passionate for you. I've been doing all this for you, that, the other thing. And basically saying, you don't care. You haven't noticed, you know. I've been following your game plan. It doesn't work. You picked the wrong guy. I mean, he has all these wrong views of himself and God. God lovingly gives him an understanding and shows him something about what that really means. See, he doesn't just deal with him spiritually. He dealt with him physically. He dealt with him spiritually. And if we just deal with depression and someone who has suicidal tendencies just on a spiritual level, then basically we can just tell them, hey, you know what? Just show some faith. Buck up. That always helps. No, it don't help. Quit sinning. You just quit sinning, stop making mistakes, everything would get better. We've even having a bad view of God would even try to tell somebody that because you're feeling depressed, or maybe you're just feeling bad, like a Moses or an Elijah or a Jonah, that, you know, your depression is just a betrayal of the faith. I've heard it. It breaks my heart. You know, the fact that God listens to him as well, is that he also cares for him mentally and psychologically. He lets him talk it out. God takes care of him physically, spiritually, and psychologically. Lets him talk it out. But not exclusively psychologically either. Because then all we have to do is just go and talk it out and everything gets better, right? I want you to see that God goes after it all. And that's the God that you and I serve. And that's the reason that we have to not only encourage ourselves in the Lord, but encourage one another in the Lord to pursue God. Because he's the one who's going to reach out to us physically, spiritually, and psychologically. Look at the end of verse 10. Here's Elijah. He goes, I am the only one left. God now goes right after his assumptions. And God gives him a word. And that word is that we need to confront the lie. We need to confront the lie. And sometimes, you know, sometimes either we don't say it enough and tell people, no, you are valuable, you're precious, and you're important to me. Don't fall in the trap, which I do all the time, you know, and just saying, well, they should know. They should just know, right? We do that to our spouse. We do that to our children. They should just know. I would ask us to follow God's example and allow him to go and speak. The reality of God is, I believe, is far greater than than Elijah's conceptions of God. He has a framework. He has a theological point of view. His expectations is what's driving him into the ground. He wanted to see revival. He wanted to see revolution. He wanted to see, you know, all these things out. This was going to happen. How many of us have those expectations in our marriage, in our relationships, in our finances? And then we get depressed. And we're broken. and we're shattered on the ground. And this is why it's so important for us to rest in His presence, to not try to go follow our hopes and our dreams and our agenda, but to pick up God's hope and God's dream and God's agenda for our life. It says here that he went to Mount Horeb. Now, Mount Horeb has another name for the mountain. It's also called Mount Sinai. It's where God had called the Israelites out. They went to Mount Sinai. And then it's amazing that he spoke to Moses and to the people to come up, and he spoke to them through a fire, and he spoke to them through an earthquake, and he shook the ground, and God spoke, and the people were terrified. But here with Elijah, the fire came, but he didn't speak through the fire. He didn't speak through the earthquake. He spoke to Elijah in a small voice. And Elijah could not understand that. Elijah wanted the earthquake and the fire. Give me the signs. Give me the miracle. Give me, do something. God is doing something. The reality of God is so huge. We narrow Him into this little box, and then when He doesn't apply to our little box, all of a sudden now God's not real. We get disappointed, and then all of a sudden we want to quit and give up. My friends, I can't encourage you enough how important it is. God does come, and He does confound, and He comforts us at the same time in that small voice. God is not mad at you. God's not angry with you. He would have never sent His Son to die on a cross for you and for me. God reveals His plan. He gives Elijah a word, and He tells him, listen, what you're not seeing, I'm gonna let my glory come by. I'm going to show you what I'm looking to do. And so here the angel tells Elijah, go now and anoint these two pagan kings. Anoint them. Like, God, man, your plan is so messed up. I'm supposed to be for Israel. Why are you sending me these pagan kings to go anoint them? And so what Elijah can't see, but that God can see because He sees all of eternity, and He tells him here, is that He's going to use these kings to remove Ahab and Jezebel. He said, the plan's already in set. You did your part. I got the whole universe in my hands, and every chess piece and everything is on the board, and God's in control, and you and I are not. And we got to have an unbelievable confidence in God. And He tells us in the book, we win. Woohoo! Victory, yeah. Revelation, read the book. We win. God's going to set it all right. But like Elijah, we are not immune from depression. We're not alone either. And ultimately, we need to be able to confront the lie. Not only that he tells them that I'm going to have these two pagan kings, and also I want you to anoint Elijah as your as the one who's going to replace you, because if the other two guys don't finish it off, Elijah's going to take care of it. I want you to see the multi. God got it already. There's just no. You're not going to escape from God's plan. And this whole thing about you being the only one left. I got like 7,000 super secret agents all over the place. All right? Just because I didn't tell you all their names, but they're there. How many of us? Well, I'm the only one in church serving. I'm the only one doing it. Or we're the only church that's going to heaven. Whatever the other thing. Yeah. My friends, I want us to be able to see that God still had a plan for Elijah. God still used him. We need to see that it's not a sin to feel bad. We need to trust God for the outcome and believe him for all that he's going to have. And my friends, I want us to say that this is why the good news for us is critical. And we need to say it. We don't say it enough. It's not the end. The best is yet to come. We win. God wins it for us. We're in the victory. We're not battling for victory. We're battling in victory. It's a totally different point of view. We have to have the right concept and understanding of who our God is. Because, my friends, there are many people's lives that are counting on us. You know, when we saw the video with Rick Warren and his wife, there were so many other videos, but I just want you to know that no one's immune. Doesn't matter whether you're a pastor or public official or whatever. None of us are immune. We got to just keep on trusting God for our marriages, our family, our children. And when we get to those places, when we will, that we don't understand what in the world God's doing, we just got to trust that God is good. And his plan for me is the best. I want you to see that God has sent his son to you and to me for that reason. I want you to understand that God listened to the cries of our hearts and provided his son so his blood would be shed and his body would be broken so that you and I would have hope. Jesus died so that you and I would live. Jesus was condemned so that you and I would be set free. Jesus came. He gave us his son to pay our debt. He was rejected so that you and I would be accepted. No greater picture of that than when we come to communion. My friends, the only thing that's going to break the bondage, yes, we need each other. Yes, there are times where we have to rest and take a nap. Make sure that we're not eating 15 pounds of sugar. You know, whatever else, maybe bad eating habits. It does affect us. There's no doubt. Yes, we also have to break the bondage. We have an enemy out there who's intentionally trying to cut us. There is a spiritual battle going on. We have to battle every day for hope. Psychologically, we need our minds renewed. It's a full peace. And God's looking to redeem and heal. Let's all stand. There are so many opportunities. We need to watch each other's backs. I'm going to ask you, just out of the brokenness of my own heart and my own failures of not asking the question and pushing hard enough. I didn't want to offend somebody. I didn't want to get their hurt feelings. I mean, like, I really kind of know. I was clueless. If you have any doubt, man, you know what? Man, just ask the question. Listen, are you thinking about taking your life? No. It's better that you ask the question out of love and concern for somebody, whether they like you or don't like you. Don't live with the regret. It don't taste good. It's terrible. I want to take a moment and pray. I want us to pray. Maybe there's some here who are struggling. I'm telling you, there is no shame. You're in a safe place. No stigmatism. There's no sin. And feeling bad or being sick, no sin in that. There's healing in Jesus. If you need to come forward, and please come forward. There's hurt, maybe a family member, maybe you've lost a family member, or a neighbor, or a friend, or a co-worker, or someone that you cared about. Come and lay it at the cross. Let God light a fire in us. Let us begin to fight victory and this defeat, this appeal of suicide. This is not of God. So as this song is being played, feel free to come forward, take the communion elements, hold on to them. There's two pieces, take both. If you want to come and pray, we'd love to pray, just spend some time at the altar. God wants to listen to your cry. Just play this song, and then come back and pray.
The word says, with the spirit of heaviness, put on the garment of praise. And that's how we fight our battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. What we're doing tonight. This is how I fight my battles. 'Cause when you think you're lost, it may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
Hey.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
Oh,
it may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. This is how I fight my battles.
Lord is our great victor. He purchased a victory for you and for me that breaks the bondage, it looses the chains. It's the only hope that the world has. It's the hope that our spouses, our children, our neighbors, our co-workers, they need to hear the good news of Jesus. That our Father in heaven recklessly loves them. And he sent his Son, and his body was broken, and his blood was shed so that we could be brought in. I pray that there would be a boldness in us, a boldness of humility and grace and truth and compassion to speak into people's lives, even if it means that they don't like us anymore. Let's take his body and blood together. Father, I love you. I thank you, Lord, for your grace and your mercy. I pray, Father, just for a fresh wind of your Spirit to move in your people's hearts. And Father, as you brought fire on the altar, Lord, because Elijah asked, I pray, Father, for fire on the altar of every single person's heart here. Let us be your light in the midst of the darkness around us. Let us defeat, Lord, this appeal, Lord, with suicide that is just, Father, it is terror. It's an epidemic. Father, we pray you would break it in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord, in your Son's precious name. Amen. God bless you guys. Have an awesome evening.
Rising to I came home from work and she was waiting at the door. Had that bad day look in her eyes. And I heard the sound of a little feet across the hardwood floor. And I knelt down with my arms open wide. When I asked her what had happened, she pointed to our son and said, "Why don't you show your daddy what you've done?" And I could see the writing on the wall, evidence of little hands. Picasso with a purple crayon. And I tried to act upset, but I was smiling through it all, 'cause I could see the writing on the wall. It was the first day of school, standing by the laundry door, wondering how third grade came so fast. I took a ruler and a Sharpie pen, and I drew the line once more. So amazed at how the time had passed, with a backpack full of promise and wonder in her eyes, I turned my head just so she wouldn't see me cry. 'Cause I could see the writing on the wall. Seems no matter how I try, the pages of